Now, from my other videos, you might have already seen the first of my HP vintage printers, the Hewlett-Packard Syncjet, the first of the inkjet printers. But as luck would have it, recently I chanced upon something older and more substantial, an HP 2631G. And this guy was under a pile of much lesser printers and more modern ones. This one is 1978 and f covered with dust, but I recognize that. And this is the real deal. 15-inch paper, tractor drive for papers with holes. It's a dot matrix printer, 180 characters per second. The drive, no, has none of these belts. This is a true screw drive. And they are said to be very reliable. So I had good hopes that this one would work. So I just took it. And under the dust was this very beautiful printer. So let's see if we can make it work. And they are said to be very reliable, so I expected this one would work when I put the ribbon in, but it does not. Well, I think that's better than last time I turned it on. Last time all the lights were on, but the buttons do nothing, self-test does nothing, line feed does nothing. It looks essentially dead. Then there were four captive screws at the bottom. And here we go. Using this. Okay, it's a complicated beast. I'm going to have trouble if I have no schematics for this. Plenty of boards over here. Huge caps. Okay. Nip, we have a dead processor. So while I was replacing the cars, I noticed something that cannot be good here. This is the top connector assembly, and this one has been repaired. It's been cracked. There's a glue. You can see the glue even better on it if this darn thing would like to focus on it. Some glue right here, and the connector bows. And definitely, I have different results if I unplug one car and I plug those two. With either those or those two, I get different results. So this connector is not making contacts everywhere for sure. So I need to change this first. Well, wouldn't you know it? You find everything in Silicon Valley. I couldn't find this connector on eBay or anywhere. But I, my local surplus store, found something pretty close. It's the same thing except it has ears, so I should be able to replace it. Rip the PCB. All right, it's coming out. All right, new connector. It's a little bit bigger, but it's just ears. Okay, it just fits. I don't expect it to solve all my problems, but it should make things better. One, two, three. Aha! Okay, now when it powers on, it beeps. It stops, and there's one light here that's blinking. Not sure what it means. Can I place it online? What? Doesn't like to be placed online. Self-test works. Nope. Reset. Nope. Well, a little bit of more life. You know, I have a stupid thought. If it beeps when I press online, it doesn't want to go online. Maybe it's just complaining it doesn't have enough paper. That would be silly. So, this is right here. And in there. So let's see if that goes any better. No beeping. It goes online. Does it self-test? It does. Oh, my paper is not wide enough. I repaired it. Self-test okay? Well, it's not perfect, but it's definitely a lot better. Yeah, it does like 4 feet. Yippee-doo! I resurrected it from the dead. I need to work on the head. Clean the head, there's some pins that are not working. Woohoo! Pretty good. Okay, so it was a bad connector, so it goes in my collection of failed vintage parts. One more. All I have to do is untighten them, not remove them. Oh yeah, there's a connector. Okay. Out it goes. It's a lot better now, you can actually see the wires. Okay, so reinstalled, and a few screws were loose, and also there is this lever here that's apparently the important adjustment. Okay, it turns out my friend Carl had an extra box of paper delivered to him that was mistakenly the wrong size for him, but it's the good size for me. So 15 inch of paper forms here. And the right way to feed it on this machine is from the underside, actually. It has very good paper flow. It goes right through the middle. All right, so let's see what we can print. Right now, not much but the test stuff. Right, so first self-test. All the way to the end now. So it almost works. I was able to print a few characters from my HP 85 on the HPIB, but it always thought this was on address 0, no matter how I set the switches here. So it's not responding to the HPIB address. So let's see if there's something disconnected somewhere. That's so weird. Now that would be a first, a dip switch that doesn't work. But at least it's a simple failure. So I'll be darned, why wouldn't a dip switch work? So even though it's a $1 part or a 50 cents part, I had to be curious and open it up. And the way this one is made is there's little rockers with little springs, and it pushes little gold balls around. And you can see the ball is contaminated, it sticks.
all of them. So maybe if I clean that, I'll repair my dip switch and save 50 cents. Man, they're super sticky. So can you put a dip switch back together? Okay, dip switch test coming up. I have repaired a dip switch. Oh well. Man, this beast is heavy. Okay. So here we go, HPIB, address 1. Over to my HP85 and see if we can print something now. Okay, this is the big moment. Online and over here, printer is 701. Print, hello, I am a repaired printer. Ha! All right, it worked. Woohoo! Let's see, I have a program listing over here. Ah, better. Moving like crazy on the table, but it works! Look at that! Dancing. All right. Offline. 4 feet. Nine feet. And we have a beautiful line printer. All right. So now I can make a demo that I was thinking of. That's for the next video.